power of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of your Son. Grant that as by his death he has recalled us to life, so by his continual presence in us, may he raise us to eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. Good morning. Welcome to Taft United Methodist Church. My name is Tom Earl Burton. I'm so blessed to be here, and what a blessing it is to see you here this morning. Happy Mother's Day. It's good to see you all. And for those who are at home, we pray that someday soon you'll be able to join us. And until then, we're going to continue to record so that you can worship here at Taft United Methodist Church. If you will, open your bulletins, you'll see in the very back our announcements for this week. And if you open it up, you'll see our prayer list on the inside left and church information on the inside right. If you need to get in touch with the office or with me, our information is there. Just give me a call. And finally, if you have a smartphone, if you will, take it out, take a picture, check in. Let everyone know that this is a place, a safe place, to come hear a life-changing message of Jesus Christ. And if you will remain seated, we're going to continue with our worship in the garden.
Why do you sin? forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Thank you.
so glad y'all are here today. I want to tell you about one of my favorite books growing up. And I'm sorry that I wasn't able to find it. I went home this last week and looked for it. I couldn't find it, but it was one of the neatest little books that I had. It was called Are You My Mommy? Did anybody ever have that book? Okay. Now, I don't normally make too many mistakes. We'll talk about that next one. So I'm going to make some mistakes in this book because it's been a while since I've read it. But if I remember right, this little bird either falls out of the nest or gets lost, and this little bird goes around, and to everything that this little bird comes across, for instance, I remember one of them was a tractor. I don't remember anything else outside of that, but there were a lot of times that this baby bird bumped into something, and you know what it would ask? Are you my mommy? How many of us think our mommy is very, very important to us? Yes, our mothers are very important to us, and today is Mother's Day. And so we honor not only our mothers, but did you know that every single lady that you come up to today in church, and if you were to ask, are you my mommy, you know what the answer would be? The answer is yes, we're a church family. And all of the older ladies older than us are some of the older ladies get mean when you talk like that. We're family. And so all of the moms help raise us and help us to be who we've been called to be. So I want y'all to do something for me today. I want you to go today, and if that person is here, because your mommy can be your mommy can be your aunt, your mommy can be your grandmother, your mommy can be all of those, okay? I had lots of mothers growing up in my neighborhood. I had lots of mothers in my family. I had lots of mothers at church, and I loved them all dearly, and they all loved me. And so what I want you to do is when you get a chance, I'm hurrying, when you get a chance, I want you to hug those people that you call mommy, okay? So we're going to turn around, Lydia. We're almost done hanging there, girl. Let's turn around, and let's pray for all of our mothers, especially for mothers who still have children at home, for it can be challenging, but God is with us. Amen. Thank you all this morning for coming down and giving an offering into the little church. I love y'all, and I appreciate y'all, and I want y'all to make me a promise, okay? When we're done here, I want you to go back and hug your mommy, or hug the ladies that love you that could be your mommy, and turn around to the other ladies in the church and wave at them and say thank you. Can y'all do that for me? All right, who can do that? Can y'all do that? All right, let's pray. Lord, we are thankful. Thankful for our mother. We're thankful for all of the ladies that you have brought into our lives that were also our mother, who lived godly lives, who loved us, who were kind and gracious to us, and have helped raise us. Lord, for all of the women of your holy church, we're grateful and we're thankful. We pray blessings upon them on this special day. Be with them, help them to be who you call them to be, and help us to love them. Forgive us of our sins. All this we ask in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Thank you all for coming up here this morning. You may return to your seats. This is the most beautiful sound that a pastor can hear. And I'm not talking about the sound of someone taking a crying baby out of worship. I'm talking about children in worship. Amen? I have shared with this with you all before, that when I was a youth director and got called into ministry, it was 2.5 years at my first church before there was a little one. I was the youth group in my church. There was no one younger than me at that time. And that Sunday morning, that young one got up and started running around, and I said, let him run. And we all had a blast. It's a joyous occasion when these kids are in worship with us. Amen. And moms and dads, y'all are doing a wonderful, wonderful job. We love you. We're praying for you. And now at this time, if you will, please stand as you're able. And let's pass the peace of Christ with one another. Let us pray. Lord, we are thankful for your many blessings. We're thankful for the many ways that you have given to us over and over and over again. And Lord, we're thankful and grateful for this opportunity to give back just a little, to show you how much we love you. Lord, bless this offering here today. Use it to further your kingdom. All of this we ask in Jesus' name. be seated. I want to make an announcement that I forgot to make earlier. This next Sunday is Senior Sunday. If you will, please be here to honor our graduating senior as well as all graduating seniors. If you will, please do so. And then finally, we want to recognize all of the women of Christ Holy Church. To all the ladies that are here today, Happy Mother's Day. If you're Methodist, you can say, and also with you, that is appropriate. This is a wonderful day for, there is something that we all have in common outside of Jesus Christ, and that is we all have a mother. Now, for many of us, we had wonderful childhood. It's not so for everyone. And so the way that we will honor our mother this morning will be through this special time of prayer for our moms. Let us pray. For our mothers who have given us life and love, that we may show them reverence and love, we pray to the Lord. For mothers who have lost a child through death, that their faith may give them hope and their family and friends support and console them, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For women, though without children of their own, who like mothers have nurtured and cared for us, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For mothers who have been unable to be a source of strength, who have not responded to their children, and have not sustained their families, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Loving God, as a mother gives life and nourishment to her children, so you watch over your church. Bless these women that they may be strengthened as Christian mothers. Let the example of their faith and love shine forth. Grant that we, their sons and daughters, may honor them always with a spirit of profound respect. Grant this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Before we get to our sermon today, I want to address something that I said in last Sunday's sermon. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Not that it wasn't brought to my attention immediately every day that I came to the office this last week. And about the third or fourth day, I realized that I had misspoken. Linda, you knew what I meant. What I said was this, that when God gave us free will, God made a mistake. He made a mistake trusting it with me. I can tell you that right now. But God did not make a mistake. That's where we made a mistake. So since it was brought to my attention, and since there was much laughter over that, I wanted to let you all know that I am, to the best of my abilities, trying to preach something that's good and accurate about Jesus Christ in my sermons. So there we go. I have addressed that. We are gracious people who want to move forward in grace. Amen. And now pray for Linda, that she can be that person I just described. Our scripture today, moving on, is John. I'm fixing to make no mistake. John 15, verses 9 through 17. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing, but I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I've heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I choose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I'm giving you these commands so that you may love one another. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today we're continuing our sermon series, Living the Resurrection, and we hear Jesus tell us about this love that is described as no greater love. There has been no greater love than the love that God has for his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. This same love was passed from Jesus Christ to you and me. A sacrificial love where Jesus loved us so much that he was obedient even to the point of death. He gave his life for you and me. He lived his whole life showing us how to love, showing us the way that we're supposed to live our lives, sacrificially giving ourselves away in love for others. Now, we may not have to give our lives literally for others, but we've been called to make loving sacrifices of ourselves for others. Here are a few practical ways, some practical things that we can do that will help us stay focused on who we've been called to be in Jesus Christ. Here are some traits of sacrificial love. People who listen, help, encourage, and give. Think of the saints that you know in your life that have that kind of love that you would describe as no greater love. And I promise you, they have these and many others. They listen. No matter where they are, no matter who they are surrounded by, they listen, especially if there's a problem. And they don't just listen to be listening. They listen and they let you know that they are listening. They will say things afterwards that will let you know that they really have been paying attention to you, that they really do love and care for you. They will say things like this: I am so sorry that you are going through all of this. Or maybe something like this: I can hear that you are really, really hurt, that you're really, really upset about all that's going on in your life. And I am so, so sorry. They don't listen waiting for an opportunity to respond. They listen. They make you feel important. They make you feel loved. Out of their calling of Christ, you are important to them, and they let you know that. They let you feel God's love in the way that they listen. They help. No matter where they are, no matter who is around, they help. If you have a problem, they try to the best of their abilities to help with that problem. With all that they say and do, they not only help, but they help point the way to the Father. And they also, in doing so, will make you feel loved. they encourage. No matter where they are, no matter who they are surrounded, they are an encourager. They say positive, Christ-like words that lift up and build up. If you're around them and you have a problem, they will be one of the first ones to speak up to encourage you with whatever it is that you're going through. They will say some things like this, possibly. I'm so sorry that you are going through all of this. I'll be praying for you. I'm praying that all of this is behind you soon. Hang in there. This too shall pass. They make you feel important. One of the things that God has given me is in my ministry, I look around for things that will preach. And I can't remember when it was, but it was on Interstate 30, and it was a horrible storm. And I knew where I was going, and I was only going about 30 miles an hour, and I could barely see the vehicle in front of me. And God placed it on my heart. There are people like this in their lives. Everything that they're going through has got them to where they can only see this far ahead of themselves. All they see is storm. All they see are problems. But see, that day I had looked on the weather map and I knew that this storm was passing through. And God reassured me. There's better weather ahead. To this very day, I have used that in my ministry. I know that what you're going through right now feels like it'll never end. It's dark. It's scary. It looks like God is not there. But I can promise you, there are better days. No matter what, there are better days ahead of you. It's just that you're in a storm. A storm that will pass. And very soon, things will be clear again. The kind of people that always encourage, they make you feel loved. They give, no matter where they are, no matter who they're surrounded by, they give. If you have a problem, they will give of their time, they will give of their talents, they will give in whatever means that they can to help you with whatever it is that you're troubled by. With all that they have, they will do their best to help you out of a bad situation. They will not only help, but in doing so, they will point the way to the Father. As they are helping you out, they will say, I have been blessed and I've been called to bless you. They don't just do it to build themselves up. They do it to build the person who needs encouraging up. And they do so in a manner that points the way to our Heavenly Father. And they make you feel loved. Do you know of anyone that has these traits? I do. And she's the reason, in some respects, why we are here today. Her name is Anna Jarvis, and she was a Methodist laywoman in the Methodist Episcopal Church in Grafton, West Virginia. She was a godly woman. She was a saint. She was a wonderful daughter who loved her mother, and she loved and honored her mother so much that she wanted to continue to do so, to love and honor her mother, even after she had passed away. And not just honor her mother. She knew this was important for all of us. She wanted to honor all mothers. Her mother had passed away on May the 9th, 1905. So in May of 1907, 2 years after her mother passed away, Anna Jarvis, a laywoman in the Methodist Church, organized a special worship service to honor all mothers. By 1908, she was advocating that all mothers should be honored on the second Sunday of May. And in 1912, the Methodist Episcopal Church recognized and began what we are continuing here this morning, a special Sunday to honor all of our mothers. Mother's Day. The same love that God had for Jesus Christ was passed down to us. And our challenge is to pass this love along to others. And so here is our challenge. Surprise. Listen. Everywhere you go, no matter who you're surrounded by, I promise you, if you'll listen, God's going to say something like this. Did you hear that? And when you hear God say something like, did you hear that? That's an opportunity for you to listen and love and to point the way to Jesus Christ. No matter where you go, if you listen, you'll hear someone who needs some help. And God has blessed you, or God has blessed you to know someone who's even more blessed maybe than you are, that you can connect that person with the help that they need. And it may just be that the help that they really need at the time is that you would stop and spend some time with them, that you would listen, that you would treat them with respect, that you would show them the love that God has for you that has been there so that you can show it to others. Encourage. Be an encourager. Everywhere you go, with whoever it is that you're surrounded with, God is going to give you an opportunity to encourage someone. It may be that you are tempted at the time to really let someone have it. That may be a wonderful opportunity for you to encourage someone. You'll do better next time. It's going to be okay. You're doing a great job. Maybe that person is dealing with things that are deeper than that. And when you encourage them, maybe the real thing that's behind what they said will come out, and that will give you an opportunity to minister someone in a very powerful way. Be an encourager. This world today is in need of people who will go about with a smile on their face, letting everyone know it's going to be okay. This is a beautiful day. No matter what it is that you're going through, God loves you. God is with you. Hold your head up. It's a beautiful day. If you think you're burdened with problems, you are. Hear the good news. Opportunities. Opportunities abound. The more we are covered up with problems, the more opportunities we have to spread the love of Jesus Christ as we work our way through life's issues. And finally, give. Give of your time. Give of your talents. Be there for people. That's powerful. For people that are going through difficult times, just to sit and listen, just to sit while they're even sleeping, maybe. How reassuring it is for someone who's terrified to know that someone is awake watching over me. What a powerful, powerful image that is of what God does for us. And if they say something, you can say, isn't it amazing that our Father does this every day and every night, that He stays awake watching over you and me. So I want to challenge you this week to remember, no greater love was given from our Father to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And no greater love was given from Christ to you and me. So that we can offer to the world no greater love. Here in just just a little bit, we're going to walk through these doors into our mission field. And there are people who need to hear the love of God. I want to encourage you to listen, to help, to encourage, to give. And whether your experience with mom was a blessing or not, I want you to hear that God, through your mother, gave you life. And if that's all you have, that's enough to respect and honor your mom. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, may we leave this place today living the resurrection in our lives, showing the world no greater love. And everyone said,
Amen.
Amen. If God has spoken to you today, calling you to join Christ Holy Church, come forward during the singing of our hymn of invitation, "Lead On, O King Eternal." If you will, please stand as you're able. Be known to everyone, the Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, may we leave this place, living out the resurrection, showing the world no greater love. Go in peace. Amen.